It's so great to look out over a full Bailey Court. Welcome to all of you. I'm Judy Koch, the Richard and Elizabeth Curry Chief of Public Programming and Learning. And I'm very excited to have everybody here tonight. In public program and learning, we present talks and special events and performances and studio art classes that engage over 250,000 people per year. We welcome you tonight, acknowledging the Indigenous people of Ontario, whose rich history on this land goes back for thousands of years. We're pleased to welcome Beijing-based multidisciplinary artist Song Dong to Toronto on the occasion of his exhibition Song Dong's Communal Courtyard, which makes its debut in Canada here today. We're also thrilled that the exhibition will be home to 15 weeks of artist-led performances and activations. So check the website to see what's happening. And tonight, for instance, Kelly Aiken will be leading a drawing program there. So it's also my great pleasure to thank the Ira Gluskin and Maxine Granofsky Gluskin Charitable Foundation for their generous support of this exhibition. So following Song Dong's talk, there'll be an opportunity for questions from the audience. We'll wrap up at about 6:30, and at that point, we invite all of you to come downstairs to see the exhibition and for the opening reception in Walker Court, where remarks will happen at 7 p.m. So at this time, I'd like to welcome our president, the president of the Board of AGO Trustees, Maxine Granofsky-Gluskin, for a very special announcement. Maxine?
Thank you very much, Judy. And good evening, everyone. Welcome to the AGO. Tonight is a very special night, as Judy said, and we're so pleased to have Song Dong here to share his extraordinary exhibition with us. Thank you so much, Song Dong, for being here with us. It was a long way to come. But there is another reason why tonight is very special. And I don't want to take too much time away from the lecture, but you might be aware that we announced today that we have hired a new director and CEO here at the AGO. And he is here with us this evening, and I wanted to introduce you to him in a few minutes. But before I do, ask Stefan Joost to come up to the podium to say a few words, I'd like to say a few words about Stefan. Stefan is a warm and engaging leader who is so passionate about art. And he's had a very long history building upon the successes at each institution that he has led. Stefan is highly intelligent, curious, resilient, high energy, and very open. He understands the importance of community engagement and partnerships and has a deep respect for artists and other creators who make what we do here possible. He is all of those things and much more, which is why Stefan is a perfect fit for the AGO. And once you get to know him, I think you will all agree with me. So please join me in giving Stefan a warm Toronto welcome. Stefan Joost.
Thank you for your kind words, Maxine, and for the support of Song Dong's work. Today, it's really about the artist's work. I wanted to basically say hello quickly and also to really say this is exactly the kind of programming that I think we should all be proud of, what Stephanie created with the artist. The reality is museums need great artists, right? And great artists often need museums. And I want to make sure that we are connecting with the artist community here and making sure we're also participating in a global conversation. I can't imagine a better example than that today. I really admire the degree in which the AGO reaches out into the community and also thinks about our role locally, but also internationally. I'm going to slip downstairs for about 3 minutes to say hi to the Youth Leadership group here. There are a bunch of 16, 17, 18-year-olds who want to be involved in the museum and are giving great time. So I'm going to go down there, say hi to them, and I'm not going to miss this. I'm going to race right back up because I know Stephanie is going to facilitate a wonderful, intelligent dialogue. So thank you very much, Stephanie.
How's that for good timing, right? To be kicking off this exhibition and the extraordinary community connections that it fosters, as well as the global integrity and artistic excellence that it represents, at the same moment that we are welcoming a new director and CEO who is so committed to those very things. It's really a special occasion for all of us. But as he said, tonight is primarily about Songdong, who is smiling at me from the audience, and I'm so grateful to have the opportunity to have you here, that you did come all of this way from Beijing, not only for tonight, but to really work with us. Songdong has been with us for over a week, working in the gallery space, working with our team, meeting with the artists in residence who are creating wonderful new works in response to his work. And he's been amazingly generous and caring, intelligent, and just an extraordinary pleasure to work with. So I want to thank you for that. I've had the great pleasure of knowing Songdong for 16 years now. We first met in Chicago when I was working there, and we've had several occasions to cross paths over the years. So it was really a wonderful moment not even a year ago, when I first found out about the possibility that this wonderful work, The Wisdom of the Poor, Communal Courtyard, might possibly be something that we could entice its then owner to give to the AGO. So I think it's important to know that this large installation, which is site responsive, it changes each time it's presented, from its debut in the Venice Biennale in 2011 to its presentation in the Margulies Foundation's warehouse space in Miami in 2013, now at the AGO in 2015. It's now here, it's with us, it will change each time, and it is ours. It is something that we can connect to and reconnect to over time, over the years, as it will take new forms in our galleries and help us find new ways to connect to our community. So we are now the stewards of a great work of art, and it is our privilege to be in that role as caretakers. This piece is part of a broad practice. I know that Songdong is only going to tell us a little bit about some of the works that are most closely created to this piece. You'll have a chance to see a kind of slice of his practice. But I think it's important for you to know that his practice is varied and deep. He is a multidisciplinary artist who came into contact with art in the 80s in China as a young man, as an art student. He's lived through times of great change in China. In the late 80s, when he was in university, this was the time that of the kind of opening of China, the quick shutting down in the Tiananmen Square uprisings in 1989, and then a gradual unfolding and reopening that has just accelerated exponentially since then. And his work has kind of tracked a number of these changes. And it includes poetry, it includes a poetic performance, it includes installation, it includes photography, works that happen in public, works that happen in gallery spaces. There's a whole range of practice that I encourage you to explore and to get to know beyond the context of the talk tonight. And we'll be able to dig into it a little bit further in conversation as well. He will be joined on the stage by his interpreter. I've been saying translator, but it's actually his interpreter, Yan Yan, who will be available to facilitate if needed, but he is going to be speaking with us in English, for which we are grateful. He's going to be wonderful in that, as well as all of the other ways that he's sharing his time with us. So, Songdong, please come to the stage, and he'll be speaking for about 30 minutes, and then we'll follow with a dialogue and open it to conversation with all of you.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming here and to show my work and to listen my speech. My English not so good because I'm from poor people. my English also poor. So I try. I can say something and you can clear my thinking and my life. So for me, I think life is my art. My art is my life. So you can see the images. I start from 1995, I start to do this work. I call that is a water diary. It's a writing diary with water every day. So this is my experience from my when I was very young. So I learned how to write calligraphy, use the ink with the Chinese brush, write on the newspaper, old newspaper. So I write not well, so my father told me, you should really work really, you need work very hard. But I said, oh, I haven't read paper, a good ink and a good brush, so I cannot write very well. But my father told me, yeah, a lot of master, they learn how to write down the Chinese words. It's just to use water. So since that time, my father stopped, I used any papers. So just the use of water to write down the calligraphy on the stone, on the floor. But you know, I'm young boy. I'm really don't like that. But I like that it's like a game. It's in summertime, so I can write down something, but I can see the words later gone. It's like the game, it disappears. So I think this is my experience. When I grow up later, is also still a little boy. So one day my classmate, I saw his face, it's half the blood. So I asked why. And he told me his father hit him, made the blood because his father saw his diary. So I am very afraid. So diary is a very dangerous thing. You cannot really write down what you want. So I stopped writing diary. So when I grow up, so in the young people, and I watched the television, I saw the bad people, the police to catch him to put into the prison. Then to develop from his diary and know what's the reason he did. So I think the diary is really terrible. So I'm afraid. And also if you say something, something may be wrong, you cannot say anything. Because I lived in the country, so it's interesting things. Sometimes you can say something, but sometimes just close up your mouth. So I want to say something because I love freedom. So a lot of the memory come back. So I write down the diary with water on the same stone since 1905. In the beginning, I think that is my work, artwork. So I should to take some photograph. So I made the 4 photographs. But later I think, so if I take a photograph, but still can remember something. So I stopped the recording and never to do the video. So now I still to do that. It's a part of my life. So I call my life is a doing nothing life. Later, I doing so many different things and artwork. I do video performance, installation, and painting, and sculpture, and the theater work, yeah, many. But one day, so I got really shocked things, is when my father suddenly passed away. So the whole family to get the very sad area. So since that time, so I cannot do something. And also my mother, she is a very happy person, but since that time, so she didn't see the book and reading the book and the silent stayed at home, just cry and put all of the stuff full of the table, full of the bed, full of the floor. So I think this it's very messy. So I with my old sister to try to organizing her room. So I threw a lot of things away. We are organizing the perfect room, perfect house for her. And she saw that, she's very angry. And she said, this is my life, you cannot control me. So I cannot sleep whole night. I rethinking a lot. So I asked my mother, why you keep the old of things and put full of the room? And she said, your father not here. So pass away forever. So I really afraid empty room. So if I saw the object and the stuff, so memory come back. So since that time, I think my mother really touched me, so let me rethinking something. So I decide, I give my mother one job. It's like organizing her stuff. So I just ask my mother to put the same things together. So it's like the family work, family job. So I have many chance and to go back home and to discussion and talking with my mother and organizing the thing together. So 3 years later, I have a chance to show this work. But before that, I talking with my mother, I want to show what you have. But she said, I cannot show this work. Because if I show that, it's not good for you. Because your friend know your mother is messy. But I always use one way to say something. It's like I told my mother, if I do this work, I will be famous. So she said, if I really can help you, so I can do. So my mother always to touch me is they can do everything for their son. So we have we use 1 month to display the work and still organizing, and we have the first show in Beijing in 1998. So here you can see this the first time I show this work in Beijing. So that is the stuff. It's not totally stuff of my life, but I saw that it's there was for me. It's the rubbish, you know. In Beijing now, you know the house is very expensive. For 1 square meter is we will take a lot of money, but I always said so. We use very cheap things. It's the garbage. We don't spend a lot of the space, so this that waste. But my mother always said, waste not. So for daily things, we can keep them and we can use in the future. So during the exhibition, so many people came there, and they said, this is your home. This is not your home. It's my home. Because you know, during Cultural Revolution time, for each family, we have the same life. And also, I asked my mother to write down something talking a story and a memory about each object and for our family life. I think this work is talking three relationships. One is a people to people. It's like I work with my mother. I love my mother, but I bring my mother to art area. And also I bring my family, the personal things, and to the public space. And I let my mother to talking with another people. And the second relationship is people to object. It's for each piece, it have our own memories. And the third one, relationship is object to object. Because a lot of objects put together, you can see different age, different generation to use them. So you can see the shape and how to different generation how to look like beauty and how to think about our life. And after this show, so my mother changed the life, and she told me she have the second life. So I think I study again from her generation. So I know she keep all of the things is for me, is also teach to me. So she is really happy. And later we have the big show in MoMA, and so many people came there and to share experience for this work. But a lot of people to ask me the same question. How big your home there? Where you keep them, all of them? So this is a very good question. So I rethinking. So I think, I keep things in the public space because I lived in the courtyard. You know, in Beijing, we have many traditional area. There's always, we lived in a small hutong. But for the staff, we share a lot of the different space, the public space in the courtyard. I will show you. Oh, sorry. Another story. I think this is very important. Is she is my mother. My mother was 4 years old for that photo. Yeah. She's family is rich. But after 49, so we got poor. So this my mother with me in the last 80s, no, 70s, I was 4 years old. So my mother told one story for me. It's about this. This is the soap. When I was married in 92, my mother to give all of the dry soap to me is the gift. I said, Mama, I use a washing machine. What's that? Yeah. So I know that it's soap, you know. But I think this look like stone. I cannot use them again. But my mother really sad and said, I will keep for you. So when I doing the waste not the work, my mother told me a lot of story about the soap. During the before I born, so my mother to keep some the piece of the soap, because for that time we need the ticket to buy the soap. So this is the ticket. So for one ticket, it just can buy the half of the whole piece. So for my family, 1 month just can get one whole piece. But my mother is really worried about my future. So she think, so maybe in the future, my son will have the big, huge family. So no enough soap to use. So I will keep some for him. So since that time, she start to keep the soap. So for that time, I don't know what's that. But now I know that is love. That is really the heart to give to me. So I think the memory is very important. So here you can see the area is like the courtyard area, is a traditional area in Beijing. So usually the one courtyard is one family to live inside. But after 49, there's a lot of family into the one courtyard to share the courtyard. And during Cultural Revolution time, it's so many family to share one courtyard. So for my courtyard, it's like more than 10 family to share. So the people want to keep the things where they can keep. So on the street, there's a small street we call that hutong. So they put the furniture there, then they can get the most space. And they also can build the small the room in the public space. So I got this idea is from Westnot, because many people ask me the same question. So I think, oh, our family with my neighbor is used the same way to share the public space, some underneath, some up the on the roof. So I think why they can keep the things. They want to get them in the public space because they haven't any rights and power. So I think the poor people, they want to get the more happy life also. They want to get the most space also. But they haven't rights. So they can bring, borrow another things the right and to get the space. For example, if you have the one furniture you want to throw away, but you can, that generation always think waste not. They keep them in the street, but that they can make this become the storage. Is not to keep the clothes, it's came, it's become the vegetable case, and to keep the like the daily life things inside. So I get the idea to bring the memory back, to do something. So for that time, the furniture, we need the ticket to buy also. So a lot of family, they ask the worker, and also sometimes they do by themselves to handmade the furniture. That is the ticket for the furniture. That the drama is the show in the past time, the people how to make the, it's like this time, this kind of the furniture. So this is a courtyard. So I start to do this work. I call that wisdom from poor. Because I think the very normal people, poor people, they haven't read, but they have the very good idea. They can borrow the right. It's like the pigeon house. They cannot to build up the house under the roof for their self for living, but the pigeon have the rights. So they build a birdhouse. Then after 2 years, they can live with the pigeon together. But after 10 years, the government want to take down the house because Olympic game came. The government want to make the perfect the surface to show the people. But they take down the whole house, but the family said, oh, I haven't enough space because my child is a grow up very quickly. So you should to build up again for me. So government to build up again, but use the brick to build up the new building. So they use pigeons' rights and get their space. So I first time to show this work in Beijing-based. For that time, the curator asked me, what do you think about the pavilion? Because the Beijing-based in the beginning just have the national pavilion. So she said, so if the artists can do their personally the pavilion, what do you think? I said, I really love to do that because I think art is not only to make one work standing there. We can share experience and also we can bring different artists, different thinking together into the one place to make the dialogue. So I like this idea. It's from my courtyard, the neighborhood, the how to relationship each other. So we built up the small room in the courtyard. So sometimes we discussion, sometimes it's a fighting, you know. But the neighborhood is the relationship is very well. So we, for example, when the Chinese New Year, so we have the dinner, but on our table, we have the same food because I can cook the meat, but I can make the small pot and to give them, and they made the dumpling and to give me one, you know. This is very, very closer. I think this is the dialogue I love, so I want to share the experience and into the art world. So I show this in Venice. And some artists the piece in that circle. And after that, I show in Marguerite's collection in Miami. And he have a lot of the very interesting and great artwork. So I also put the work inside and to make the dialogue. So this is here. So I just finished. So I bring the 100 piece of the furniture, the face here. It's a door and the windows. I collect them from the different area in Beijing, some from the secondhand market, and some is from outside Beijing. Usually this furniture is very important. The furniture in each family. When I was very young, this is my dream. I want to have this one in my home, but I cannot because we need the ticket, we need more money. But my father can make this. But he did, I think, three pieces. But I I think 4 years, more than 4 years to do this. Just use the Sunday to do. But the first piece to give my grandfather, and the other two pieces is to give his old brothers. When he start to do the new piece, you know, China open. So he said, now we are facing to the modernist. We should have the modern life. So I miss them. I miss all of the style of this furniture. So when I grow up, so now I become the artist. So I borrow the right from the art. So I can have a 100 piece this. And also, I hope this can also to make the dialogue with another work. So I'm really lucky this work can show in AGO. So here have a lot of great artists work in the collection. So I select many works. One is important is the silhouette work. This work is very interesting for me because this is the same age for me. He did in 66. I born in 66. And 66 also is in the beginning of the Cultural Revolution. But for that time, I think in China, no people know what is the modernism, what is the minimalism. So I put this in the circle of the these doors, and the mirror can reflect this. So this is like the mark and the limit, the talking about that time. So when I start to do something, for that time, I think I can see more about the different culture. So you can see the far away have the Ankara's work. The year is 1981. For that time, I'm 15 years old. So I just get the fresh the view and the fresh thinking in my life. But I love the Ankara because he doing the work, doing the whole life, and talking about how to spend the time. But we cannot to see his body and his face, but we just to see his work. Sometimes we see one piece of the work, just the moment, but I think this moment is talking the whole life, because time is no beginning, no the end. And also in the same wall, I put the magnet, the work. It's the big stone in the small room. That is also talking the space and talking the thinking. How big about the world? How small about the world? For me, I think the world is no big, no small. Big is small, small is big. So the stone is from universal. Universal can into the one room. But the dust inside the dust maybe have so many different universal. So it's like my work. I hope this work can bring a lot of different thinking inside the work. And also that work is the life art. So maybe in the future, 100 years later, so I don't know what's happened about these doors. So I hope that still going on and some artists can participate and play in the space. So this time I also very lovely and to work with another artist. They will have an artist residency inside to do some performance and some sound work. So here is half a bicycle. This bicycle made the Canadian artist Maury Fafro. Yeah. Right. When I was young, you know, in China, we take bicycle, every day. I think a billion bicycle there. But now it's so many car, it's terrible. In Beijing have 5 million cars. So every day I'm stopped in the highway. You know, it's like parking the car in the highway. But in the past, I think this bicycle is very important for my life. And this artist, to use the new technology and the new thinking and to think about the bicycle. I put the bicycle into the circle and put them back to the life. And also I put Oldenburger's ice cream into the circle. Oldenburger's work looks like ready-made, but it's not ready-made. It's like a painting sculpture. And for me, that is not only the artwork, it's like the culture. It's the dessert. But we saw that the ice cream is like we saw the different cultural life. It's like America culture. Here is the Andy Warhol's work. He always very popular, and to do the very popular the person into his images. So here is the very famous dancer in Canada. I use this and use the doors, the mirror reflection her images many times. So my idea is I bring them so many family into the gallery. For each furniture, it's half a, they change the five hands. So I am the sixth hand to get them. So for each time, the mirror will reflection the many different family people. The woman, they are dressing and looking at the mirror and to get what is the beauty. And the dancer, the whole life, is a lot of time is stayed in the mirror room and to see the mirror to get the very the good dancer, then to show everybody. So here is the many dialogue inside, is the experience to mix together. And also artwork become the ready-made things. So I'm really lucky and can make dialogue with the many great artists, the master. But if you can go into the circle, so you can, from the mirror, see yourself. So I hope this work you can enjoy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, that was wonderful. So, you know, it was wonderful, the setup that you offered in relation to some of your prior work when you were talking about the three kinds of relationships, people to people, people to object, and object to object. And all of those seem to be really present in Communal Courtyard. And you know, you helped us understand why you chose some of the objects. So how the object, your installation, speaks to the objects that are these works in our permanent collection. And you also talked a bit about the kind of people to people, all of the your own personal history and all of the families that have owned these wardrobes and their histories in the space. But following on what you, on your invitation to everyone to come and bring their own experience into the piece, how do you hope that audiences in Toronto will respond to your installation? So people to object.
Yeah, I think this is interesting because here is have so many different culture. It's not like Beijing. Beijing is now is become the international city. But here, I think there's so many different people from all of the world that live here. And before I reading about the Toronto, it's the very the good city and for living. So this time I'm not have enough time to see more about this. But I'm in the gallery. I saw this all of the staff that worked very well, and it's very kindness. So I think this that the furniture's the experience is from China. But I think we have the some similar experience how to look back for our life. But this work is not only to look back. It's talking about the present and the future, what we will create. So I hope the people can into that and to from the different angle and to see the work, and also we can see ourselves and to rethinking something about the whole world. Because now, you know, I think now is the screen age, screen time. So every day we watch the screen. And half a year, 1 year, so we do the old model and get the new things. So, but we should stop to have the thinking, why? We just want to get new. So we want to have a chance to make one stage and to thinking, what is the waste? So we want to get the new value from the old things. But that is the facing the future. It's like my mother told me, everything he keep that is not she keep that is not for the past. It's also to, looking for the future. Her future is me. So she said, finally everything they can use it again because I'm doing the work.
Yeah. So just to follow that up. Maybe two questions. So one thing that your work offers, I mean, we've been hearing about the idea and, you know, you as a conceptual artist, you're always looking for whatever is the right form to convey the idea that you're working with, whether that's performance or video or installation. But I've always been impressed by how sensitive you are to materials. I think that came through in the talk, in the soap, for instance. But in this installation, especially now that we've been living with it up in the gallery for a few days, I've been really moved by how beautiful it is. And the there's so much to look at, all of the subtle choices of pattern of the wood and the colors of the curtains and all of the little details that indicate the traces of daily life. So they have that kind of meaning in them, but they're also just, they're also color and pattern and form. So they're also bringing forward this kind of modernist legacy that you were talking about as well. So could you talk about your approach to materials and to form and to beauty?
Yeah. This usually we saw the furniture, so we use them, but we didn't go in and to see from the back. So I cut them. So now you see the first reel, you can see the back of them. So that is we are in the case. So usually we are outside of the furniture. So now we can go in. So I think if we change the angle to see the world will be changed. So I think that material, I didn't do anything. I didn't paint the colors and something, but that is from the life. Then still very beauty. I think the normal people is also artist, but is an unknown artist. So I bring 100 artists here to share the experience with the masterpiece.
And following that, I think, you know, one thing that we think a lot about at the AGO is how the museum can be a space for people to gather for encounters, not only with art, but also with each other. And there's something so powerful also in this case about the fact that you were generous enough to open up the edges of your installation so that it's for the first time your work is not only in dialogue with other art as it was in Venice and Miami and is with the works in our permanent collection, but also will be in dialogue with live performance art, new works created by artists here in Toronto. Could you say a little bit more about what that means to you?
Oh yeah, I think for one artist, the thinking is very small. if you can bring so many thinking into the one place, I think that will be great. So I think I open the space, open the mind. I hope bring the so many fresh ideas into the space. So I think during the future, the five months, yeah, so will be happened a lot of interesting things. So today I heard about the one Chinese girl, the artist. She want to make the mahjong, you know, the play mahjong in that site. So I'm really happy that, yeah.
And also, you know, as we've talked about the work, we're stewards of the work. We're giving it its Canadian debut now, and it's living one kind of life in the gallery at this moment. And that life will change over the coming 5 months as we continue to learn the piece and get to know it, and as others bring new energy into it, as new reflections accumulate in those mirrors. But it will have other lives in the future. Could you do you have another way that you would imagine it being shown at the AGO, say 100 years from now?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, but I think life sometimes is very short. So I call that is doing nothing. So our whole life we are doing nothing. But we know we are doing nothing, but we have to do because we spend the time with the people together and talking and the share the whole life. So I think when this in the future, so I hope they're still there, but maybe that is still become the rubbish again.
We're not going to let that happen.
Yeah, but looking forward. But we cannot to decide what the end of the world. But we know the end is the empty. But empty is the full. So for me, it's the same things.
So that might be a good moment for us to open to questions for the audience. I know we've got a couple of microphones around. I think there's...
Hello. Hello there. One of my questions is that were there any cultural or childhood games involving these furniture?
Could you repeat? Sorry.
Were there any cultural or childhood games involving with these furnitures back then?
Cultural and childhood.
Games? Were there games that you would play in the wardrobes?
childhood games, yeah. So my game is very simple. It's a writing diary with water. It's one game. Another is just play the stone. You know, it's like 下棋, 怎么说? 下棋.
Play Chinese chess.
Yeah, Chinese chess. And also, you know, you can drawing something on the floor and just running with your friend, yeah.
But did you hide in the wardrobes? When you were little, did you hide in them?
Yeah. But you know, in the courtyard, you know, it's like my work. Yeah, many angle, the many places. So you can sit there, maybe half day, and no people find you. But it's really, really boring, you know.
Well, we were talking earlier that about the Western children's book, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, and the idea that you can open a door and find yourself in a completely other reality, a kind of fantastic space. And yeah. I think that happens in the installation. It's something that you'll all, I hope, enjoy. Yeah. Any other questions?
Thank you for the talk. Song 老师, 你好.
就是想问一下,
你觉得 文化大革命对下一代的艺术家来说，他们的影响是什么？就是比你还要年轻的艺术家来说，他对他们的影响是什么？你觉得他们还是会对这个历史很关注吗？ So my question is about the impact of the history of cultural revolution to the younger generation of artists in China. Thank you.
Yeah, cultural revolution. Yeah, I born in 66, is the same age of the Cultural Revolution. But when I was the first 10 years, I think I don't know what is a Cultural Revolution. But I think, oh, this cannot go to school. It's really lovely, you know. Every day I can play. These are good things for me. But when I grow up, I heard about so many stories from my father's generation. They told me it's a really terrible time. Yeah. So they never want to get back to that time. So I think this really deeply to hit the so many heart, you know, and also to change the thinking deeply, thinking of the whole China. But I think for me, I want to forget them. I don't want to go back them that time. But I think I just to keep some of the images from that. I think that is, for me, is interesting. It's inside is empty, just the surface the images. So the question is about the young people. But I think young people don't care about the Cultural Revolution because they don't know what's happened for that time. And also we haven't the really deeply the book and the story the talking about that time things. So maybe in the future, we can open more so we can get them. So maybe it's helpful for the young people to know that that time is how horrible.
Thank you. I wanted to say that your English is really good, understood you no problem, and also it was very evocative. Your stories were really wonderful. And I was wondering about how the installation changes for you with every new iteration in Venice and Miami and Toronto. How is it different for yourself?
Yeah, for each time it's very different. So this time, because we have the artist residency, so I keep the big space in the center. So it's like the courtyard. So I built the, I think, six rooms, six circle, yeah. Relationship the different work, because this work is the collection of the AGO. So I reflection the work is a like set specific work. But in Miami is have a different different artwork, and also they can that space they can go up the second floor and from the top and to see. So that is a more is a circle things, and here I choose some painting, so I leave the white wall here. So for each time it's different. Later you go there, so you should to walk slowly and to look like the window. So from the different angle, you can see inside the mirror can reflection different work. It's very interesting, yeah.
And just as a follow-up to that, when related pieces to this one have been shown in China, in Beijing, where some of these associations to the wardrobes and their history and their use would be really evident to the audience. And here it's something that you have to teach us. What do you learn from that? How is it different for you to have the work shown in China or outside of China?
Oh yeah, it's, in China, I think it's because we have the same life. So it's like the people say this not your home, it's my home. So we can we don't need talking a lot, so they can get the message from the object. But here, I think usually from the first view is a good looking, then you can develop the what's the happened about this the background. So I select 100. The piece, but for each piece is different. It's made by hand. But if you see them, so it's similar. because for that time you cannot to really to make the really colorful things, because Cultural Revolution time, they think the beauty is simple, 朴素, 是吧?
Humble,
yeah.
Simple
and humble. So you can see they choose the color of the curtain. It's a blue, most is a blue and green. It's like the sky color and the natural color. So just it. But the red is in Cultural Revolution time is very important. But that is in the little book. And the house, the door is the red. But you cannot make the red curtain because it's look like a flag. You know, so they usually use the green and blue.
I never really heard the end. In the installation at Venice, there was so much stuff, and you said to us that many people asked you, is this really all your family's stuff? So much stuff. How big is your house? So, but I never heard the answer. Is it really, your stuff, yeah, really,
okay,
truly?
Sorry.
And how big is your house?
Okay.
And also, is that soap, the big collection of soap, did your mother collect all that soap? So much soap?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. you saw all of the object is from my family. It's not my mother collection the things. It's like didn't throw away, just keep them. My family is the huge family. It's about the total number is about 13 more family members. But it's usually my grandfather, grandmother lived with us. We have 6 rooms in the courtyard. But usually we in the room, so we pack it very well. And one by one, from the floor to the ceiling, just like that, yeah. But a lot of the new stuff, we never use them, because I bought some of the stuff of the kitchen. My mother and father just in the beginning to open that to see, oh, it's very beautiful. We can keep them in the future to use, but just to keep the in the furniture, yeah, but never use them. Yeah, they always use the old things. My mother told me, "It's you cannot waste anything. You should to use the whole life of the object. So for example, it's one paper. One paper we can drawing and write down something, but later cannot to drawing, but we can use these packing things. Then we can use that clean the floor, clean the table. That is not one life. In the end, we can burn that, made warmer, made fair. That is a life gone. That is the whole life of the object. So she always teach me to use that way to do the things. So I think I learn a little bit, so I can do something.
So Songdong, thank you so much for sharing your creativity, your imagination, and this extraordinary work with us. We are really honored to have you with us and to have this work with us. It's a piece that is so beautiful. It's so powerful in terms of all of the range of social issues that it raises. And it's quite special that it speaks in such specific ways to a culture and a city all the way around the world, but also is so grounded and relevant right here at the AGO and in Toronto. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Yeah. And thanks to all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So just one final thought. We invite you now to join us downstairs in Walker Court for refreshments, time to hang out with each other, with the artist. Also, please do spend time in the exhibition itself. It's open tonight to all of you. We have members previews Thursday and Friday. On the off chance that any of you aren't members, you can come back on Saturday when it opens to the public for real, for full. And please come back again and again, experience the residencies, and do slow down, look closely. You will be rewarded. Thank you.